Good morning again. My name is Tom Sinclair in the Department of Turkish and Middle Eastern Studies at the university here. I'm chairing this session, which has to do with atlases and maps with a nautical emphasis from the late 16th to the 18th century. And personally, I have an interest in maps. I make them myself. I will continue to make them with varying technologies. Now, let me introduce our first speaker, Professor Astengo, formerly of the University of Genoa, who will speak to us about an atlas of the 17th century, which is in the collection of Sylvia Ioannou. Please. Yes.
First of all, I must say that it is a great honor for me to be invited here. So thank you to the organization of this conference. Well, the great demand of maps, charts, atlases, and globes began in the 16th century is explained as follows by John Dee in his preface to the English edition of the Geometry of Euclid, printed in London in 1570. Some to beautify their hall, parlors, chambers, galleries, studies, or libraries with. Others some for things past, as battles fought, earthquakes, heavenly firings, and such occurrences in history mentioned, thereby, lively as it were, to view the place, the region adjoining, the distance from us, and such other circumstances. Some other presently to view the large dominion of the Turk, the wide empire of the Moscovite, and the little morsel of ground where Christendom, by profession, is certainly known, little I say in respect of the rest, etc. Some other for their own journeys, directing into far lands, or to understand other men's travels. To conclude, some for one purpose, and some for another, like, love, get, and use maps, charts, and geographical globes. According to John Dee, maps and charts were bought to preserve mainly as a decorative object, to be hanged on the walls or kept in libraries. They were used also for a better understanding of the past, for having a clear picture of the present state of the world, and last but not least, to organize travel, or in case of Portolan charts and atlases, to trace a course, or to learn how to trace it, and even to plan another campaign. The application of the printing techniques to cartography made it possible to obtain a large number of maps and charts at a relatively low price. But overall, because of the impossibility to apply the color with a mechanical process, the production of precious manuscript illuminated Portolan charts continued to prosper during the 16th century. Only in the last decades of the century, the making of charts began to draw towards an inexorable decline in the traditional center of production like Genoa and Venice, while in some other Mediterranean ports in great expansion like Messina, Marseille, and particularly Leghorn, it seems to have acquired a new vitality that lasted until the second half of the 17th century. At the end of the Middle Ages, the old Porto Pisano that was periodically getting filled with mud deposited by the River Arno was abandoned, and the little port of Leghorn became the most important call of Tuscany. After 1530, with the Duke Alessandro de' Medici, began those great works of enlargement and modernization of the town and of the port that continued under the Grand Dukes Cosimo I, Francesco I, and overall Ferdinando I. It was the last one who, as well as having ordered the building of the outer port in order to receive greater ships, issued a series of decrees directed to encourage the immigration of skilled laborers of every nationality. In particular, the so-called Costituzioni Livornine of 1593 directed to merchants of every nation people from the East and the West, Spaniards, Portuguese, Greeks, Italians, Jews, Turks, Moors, Armenians, Persians, and others, granted the freedom to fix their residence in Leghorn, the freedom of worship, the cancellation of debts contracted in other countries, and the impunity from previous sentences. These laws, exceptionally liberal for the time, attracted Jewish merchants and bankers, Dutch and English sea captains and pilots, master carpenters and sailors coming from different ports of the Mediterranean, therefore bringing growth and prosperity to the town. In order to protect the increasing maritime traffic from the frequent attacks by Turkish and barbaresque corsairs, Cosimo I had deemed it necessary to establish a religious knightly order with that precise task. Thus, already in 1561, it was constituted the Sacro Militare Ordine Marittimo dei Cavalieri di Santo Stefano, Papa e Martire, officially consecrated the following year in a great ceremony during which the Grand Duke became the first Grand Master. The order, whose statutes were approved by the Pope, was based on the one of the Knights Hospitallers or of Malta, of which it adopted even the coat of arms, but with inverted colors, argent and Maltese cross gules. Nevertheless, the Grand Master of the order was not elected, but was the Grand Duke himself. Therefore, the order was not sovereign as the one of Malta, but was substantially a second navy of Tuscany. Furthermore, the knights were in great majority coming from Tuscany, and nearly all from Italian states. Only few were from Spain, Portugal, and Switzerland. They had to reside in the Palazzo della Carovana of Pisa, both during the 3 years of training and during the periodical spiritual retreats. Next to the palace stands the Church of Santo Stefano dei Cavalieri, the Church of the Order, whose walls are still decorated with flags and streamers taken from enemy ships. The fleet of the Order, composed essentially by galleys, was stationed for a short period in the new port of Cosmopolis, now Portoferraio, in the island of Elba. Later on, it was permanently moved to Leghorn. The Grand Master was always the Grand Duke, assisted by a council, but the effective command of the fleet during the operation at sea was entrusted to an admiral, chosen among the members of Tuscan nobility. Among them, an eminent figure is the one of Jacopo Inghirami, who was in charge from 1603 to 1616, and again from 1621 to his death in 1622. Under his command, many successful campaigns against Ottoman and barbarous corsairs were carried out. In particular, in 1607, after a failed attempt to occupy Famagusta, the order fleet took the important port of Annaba in North Africa. This clear that the great development of mercantile traffic, the necessity of control of sea routes, and of a good training of the knights, the political plans of the ruling class, and in the case of Ferdinand I, even some colonial ambitions, all produce a great demand of geographical information that show itself in the acquisition of a great number of book and manuscript of geographical content and of letters and relations of travelers and merchants. But they were especially maps and charts to provide an up-to-date representation of the world that was quickly changing. The Tuscan libraries and archives are today particularly rich of Portolan charts and atlases produced in different parts of Italy, in Spain and Portugal, that once belonged to members of the Medici family or to the local nobility. It was probably the great demand of customers like the Grand Dukes and the Knights of Santo Stefano that originated the birth of a local cartographic production in Leghorn about the end of the 16th century. Vincentius Volcius, a chart maker from Ragusa, after having worked in Naples in 1592-93, in 1595 was in Portoferraio, where he made a chart of the Aegean Sea. But at least from 98 to 1601 was in Leghorn, where he produced some charts before going back to Naples, where he was in 1605-1607. His presence in Tuscany seems therefore occasional and not connected with the creation of a permanent workshop. After a long interval, during which the production seems to have stopped, it was resumed by Giovanni Oliva, member of the well-known family of chartmakers Olives, Oliva, Olive. He worked in Messina up to 1599, but from 1601 to 1615 he was active in different ports of the Mediterranean, always on the move, probably in search of better markets. There is an atlas, date 1616, that is without the indication of the place where it was made, but according to the majority of the scholars, it can mark the beginning of his activity in Leghorn. It is a richly decorated atlas of 16 sheets, and it showed the first attempt of the chart maker to correct the distortion of the east-west axis. The Mediterranean is represented in two sheets, the one made according to the tradition, the other correctly oriented. Again, in his double charts, chart of 1618, the third surely made in Leghorn, he compares the new version at the bottom with the old one at the top. And from that moment onward, all his production showed the corrected axis. After years of continuing wandering in Mediterranean ports, he seems to have settled down in Leghorn, where he opened a permanent workshop and where he continued to work at least until 1643. In 1636, he signed an atlas with Giovanni Battista Cavallini, in a certain way presenting his successor and entrusting him officially with the workshop. It consists of six charts that cover the so-called area of the normal Portolano and the world map on two hemispheres. The chart of the East Mediterranean shows the east-west axis again rotated counterclockwise, as in the medieval tradition, suggesting that the atlas, although signed by the two, could be the work of Cavallini alone, as Oliva in his charts had already permanently adopted the new design. This coming back to an out-of-date scheme is the proof that in this case we cannot think in terms of cartographic school with a regular passage of knowledge from a master to an apprentice. It is rather a matter of a simple transfer of the business from one chart maker to another. Little is known about Giovanni Battista Cavallini. From the signature of his atlas of 1652, we learn that he was Genovese geografico, Genoese geographer. He was therefore a foreigner, like Volscius and Oliva, attracted to Leghorn by the opportunity offered by the Costituzioni Livornine. In Genoa, his hometown, the activity of traditional chart makers was on the wane. The production was the monopoly of the Maggiolo family, whose members handed down from generation to generation the official charge of Magister Cartarum Pro Navigando, which granted a salary from the Republic and exclusive right of producing Portolan charts. It is true that from the end of 16th century, the monopoly of Maggiolo families was not very strict, so were some charts made in Genova by other chart makers, such as Carlo da Corte, Gio Francesco Monno, e Alberto de Stefano. But it's clear that the market was so reduced that probably Cavallini was forced to emigrate in search of more favorable conditions. We do not know where he could have had his training and when he left Genova, but it's sure that when he appears in Leghorn, he's already an expert chart maker. In fact, he had already signed in Leghorn the Great Atlas of 1635, the highlight of this conference, really a masterpiece in his production. And this before taking over officially the workshop from his predecessor. It is a precious item that surely belonged to Fernando II, Grand Duke of Tuscany, a Grand Master of the Order. It was probably very expensive, therefore the Duke himself or someone that intended to present him with a splendid gift, worth of a great library, would have not ordered it to a simple apprentice. It is composed by a full-page armorial device, a full-page compass rose, and 13 charts and maps. The first sheet contains the coat of arms, a Maltese cross gules, 5 cakes, and in chief on a berry, 3 fleur-de-lis argent, and the crown of Grand Dukes of Tuscany. Sorry. The last sheet shows an elaborated compass rose. With the Italian names of the 32 winds, the same armorial device simplified appears in the center of the drawing. The 3 Portolan charts that altogether represent the whole Mediterranean, covering the area called by Nudenschild of the normal Portolano, but the east-west axis appears rotated counterclockwise of about 9 degrees, according to the tradition, so that Gibraltar appears at the same latitude of the mouth of the Nile. The charts are lavishly decorated with large compass roses, figures of animals, trees, ships, sea monsters, and a great number of conventional ideograms representing the most important towns with their flags. The world map is delimited by a rectangular frame and represents the whole world, including the imaginary Terra Australis Incognita, the unknown southern continent, that, according to cosmographers of the time, should have existed to counterbalance the great mass of lands in the northern hemisphere. Besides the 3 charts of the Mediterranean and the world map, there are 9 maps of the most important islands of the Mediterranean, namely Cyprus, Rhodes, Crete, Malta, Sicily, Sardinia, Corsica, Elba, and Balearic Islands. They show a very accurate coastal contour and are probably derived from local large-scale Portolan charts. But their interior, except for the towns and some important landmarks, like Monte Olimpo for Cyprus, Mont Saint Elias for Rhodes, and Mongibello, the Etna for Sicily, is disseminated by little cones of the same size and of various colors that generically represent mountains with no relation with the actual relief, having only a decorative function. On the wall, the atlas was a perfect source of geographical information for a ruler of the time. The world map could provide a complete image of the new worlds, the theater of the European expansion, while the 3 charts of the Mediterranean were useful for understanding the balance of powers and for planning naval raids, showing clearly the position of enemy ports and their distance. Lastly, the large-scale maps of the island show in details the contested areas where the major clashes with Ottoman and barbaric corsairs occurred. Even the Elba Island, which is not depicted in any other work by Cavallini, apparently safe for being so close to Tuscany, during the 16th century had been raided deeply twice by the Ottoman admirals Kair al-Din called Barbarossa and by Dragut. Furthermore, the fact of being a manuscript item and consequently sole gave surely to his owner the feeling of being possessed of exclusive geopolitical information. The rotation of the Mediterranean axis would not have affected a non-nautical use of the chart. Therefore, for some years, Giovanni Battista Cavallini continued to produce decorative charts presenting the traditional orientation. In 1642, he collaborated with a Portuguese cartographer, Antonio Sanchez, to execute a large atlas representing the whole world. We don't know the details of that undertaking. We can just suppose that the two collaborated at a distance, each one in his workshop. Sanchez executed in 1641 seven charts representing the extra-European continents, and Cavallini in 1642 three charts of the Mediterranean and six maps of the islands. Probably the atlas was then assembled in Lisbon by Sanchez, who had already carried out a similar undertaking in 1633 with Giovanni Oliva. The chart of the East Mediterranean shows the traditional rotation counterclockwise. But in the same year, 1642, Cavallini realized another atlas in which the same chart shows the attempt to correct the axis. It is well known that the majority of scholars attribute the traditional rotation of the axis to the magnetic declination in order to allow their coordinate use with the compass in a direct way, avoiding complex calculation. In fact, the rotation of the chart corresponds to the average eastern magnetic declination in central Mediterranean during 14th and 15th century. With the opening of oceanic routes, sailors from the Iberian Peninsula had to get used to stay for weeks in the open seas without any coastal landmarks and were compelled to find other marks in the sky. For the practice of the astronomical navigation, they were introduced new instruments suitable to measure the height of stars above the horizon, such as the Mariner Astrolabe and the Cross Staff. And the oceanic charts were systematically oriented with the true north. But within the Mediterranean, navigation continued for a long time along the same routes, with the same rhythms, and with the same techniques of the Middle Ages. In fact, that navigation was characterized by reduced distances and short times. A pilot could not have waited until the falling of the night or 12 noon to know his position, because in few hours the ship might have gone on the rocks or dangerously too close to an enemy port. But the eastern magnetic declination, practically unchanged during 14th and 15th centuries, from the beginning of 16th century had gradually reduced, and in 17th century in central Mediterranean was zero. So, the traditional Portolan charts did not correspond anymore to the magnetic north. That's why Giovanni Oliva and Giovanni Battista Cavallini rectified their east-west axis. If we observe the chart of 1542, at first sight, we might think that the correction made empirically, simply by rotating the chart clockwise, had gone too far, producing an opposite error, so that Cyprus is depicted much south of Crete. But this is an error only if we think in terms of latitude. But if we think in terms of compass bearings, this is a correction to bring the chart up to date with the declination of the day. It is explained by Francesco Maria Levanto in his Specchio del Mare Mediterraneo, published in 1664, where he declares that the magnetic declination was northeastern in Gibraltar, then sailing east was decreasing northeastern and zero in central Mediterranean. From there, continuing to sail east, it was increasing northwestern. That will explain the clockwise rotation given by Giovanni Battista Cavallini to the East Mediterranean in order to make the chart correspond with compass bearings. Therefore, the Atlas of 1642, even if not intended for the actual use on board of ships, shows charts perfectly suited to a Mediterranean navigation, still based on compass bearings and estimated distance. An interesting work of Giovanni Battista Cavallini is surely the Teatro del Mondo Marittimo of 1652, an atlas composed by a world map in an oval frame, 10 charts representing the whole world, including the Mediterranean in a single sheet, 5 large-scale charts of section of the Mediterranean, and 8 maps of Mediterranean islands. The 10 charts of the extra-European countries seem copied from the coeval Dutch and Portuguese nautical cartography, from the great printed atlas in commerce at that time, and also from the plates of the Arcano del Mare, a large navigation treaty and atlas by Robert Dudley, printed in Florence in the years 1646-47. Sometimes Cavallini, facing the great geographical problems of his time, reaches personal solution, as in the case of California, whose nature, if insular or peninsular, was not yet ascertained, that he depicts twice, as a peninsula and as an island. Among the 5 regional charts of the Mediterranean, the 2 that represent the Ligurian and the Tyrrhenian seas at great scale, about 1 to 500,000, are of particular interest because they do not seem related to any contemporary chart, printed or manuscript. It is reasonable to think that they are copies of the unadorned chart made in the workshop for captains and pilots and used in the actual navigation. In 1654, by signing an atlas with Pietro Cavallini, probably his son, he officially conveys the workshop to a new owner, and also in this case, apparently there was not passage of knowledge from master to apprentice, because the axis of the Mediterranean appears rotated again counterclockwise. The error is present in nearly all the production of Pietro. As an example, we notice it in the Atlas of 1677, whose 3 sheets of the Mediterranean are an exact copy of these of the earliest work of Giovanni Battista, the Atlas of 1635, the one which is the center of this conference, or which it reproduces even many decorative details. Looks, for example, at the 2 ships, one with the flag of Santo Stefano and the other with the flag of Malta, which are identical to the sheet of the Atlas of 35. Only at the end of his career, Pietro, in the Atlas of 1688, corrects the rotation of the axis. The work is dedicated to Cosimo III, under whose government began the decline of the Tuscan maritime traffic and of the St. Stephen Order, whose only task was reduced to patrol the local waters. For those reasons, buyers are gradually disappeared, and the Atlas of 1688 is probably the last produced in the Leghorn workshop before its final shutting down. Thank you.